Good morning, church. We welcome you to Gillsburg Baptist Church on our first Sunday of Advent. If you're visiting with us, we're so glad you're here and that you chose to worship with us. And if you have any questions, we'd be glad to answer those for you and point you in the right direction. If you would, please pull out your bulletin. Pay attention to a few announcements, as the month of December that's upcoming has a lot of different activities in it. We want to make sure everybody is up to speed on all that. The poinsettias for Christmas, the poinsettias for our sanctuary, those orders are due today. So if you'd like a poinsettia, please, they're $15 each, and get those orders in today. Those orders can be turned in to Presley Wilson, Caleb Bean, Madeline Williams, Miss Terry, whoever you can get to, and get those orders turned in today. This week, starting today, is also the week of prayer for international missions. I know you would like to add that to your prayer list and continue to pray for that this week. Tomorrow, November the 29th, tomorrow, Monday, is the Brotherhood Rally at 7 o'clock at Woodville Baptist Church. The van will leave at 6 o'clock, so all men, boys, if you would like to go to that, be here by 6 to catch the van, and we'll see you at Woodville Baptist Church. Also want to remind everyone that Wednesday night, we have a special service Wednesday night. Supper will begin at 5:30, and then at 6 o'clock, David and Regina White, missionaries to Guatemala, will speak to us on Wednesday night. So everybody, please be here for that. Put that on your calendar. You won't want to miss that. I want to remind everyone that Saturday at 2 o'clock is the Gillsburg Christmas Parade. Saturday at 2 o'clock, the Gillsburg Christmas Parade. Next Sunday, it's a lot of stuff going on next Sunday. There will be no Sunday school next Sunday, okay? The children, K through 5th grade, at 10:30, will have pancakes and pajamas, where they'll have story time with Miss Maddie, games, crafts, and pancakes. That will happen for them, the kids, at 10:30. And then also at 10:30, the adults will be in here for a concert, Faith's Journeys Trio, 10:30, next Sunday morning, right here for a concert. So remember, next Sunday, no Sunday school. Everything will begin at 10:30. Kids will go to the back for pancakes and pajamas, and the adults will be in here for the concert, Faith Journey Trio. Also, I want to remind everyone that the service for Reefs Across America is on December the 18th at 11 a.m., and then I'm not going to read them all off to you, but if you are interested in some positions that are open, the nominating committee is working to get those filled as soon as possible. They are on the back of your bulletin. If you are interested in any of those positions, please reach out to myself, Tommy Smith, Ms. Vicki Wall, or Wanda Williams, and we'll be glad to get those positions filled. And then last but not least, the church secretary position is open. And if you are interested in that or would like any information about that, we ask that you please see a deacon for information on that. Any other announcements this morning before I turn it over to Brother Doug? If not, it's good to see everybody. I hope and trust that you had a great Thanksgiving and everybody stayed safe and spent some quality time with family and friends. And we're so glad that you're here this morning. Brother Doug, it's all yours.
Let's have our call to worship this morning. The hymn about the Advent says, "They will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. Emmanuel, let's say it in the same place. God with us.
Let's pray together. Father, we love you and we thank you, and we're just truly grateful for an opportunity this morning to come together and worship you and to start our preparation in our hearts and minds to celebrate the day that you came to be with us. You loved us so much, you came down in human form to live amongst us, and you died for us so that we would not have to pay the penalty for all the things that we do bad and all our sins. We are truly grateful for that, and we thank you for that. And we just pray, Lord, if there's someone here that doesn't know that, that they'll come to know that this morning by the way we worship you. We just lift you up now. It's all about you. It's not about us. And we sing praises to you and learn more about you and what you have to say to us through Scripture. We're just truly grateful for this opportunity and truly grateful for all these folks. And we just ask that you touch the service. You touch each and every heart here, Lord, and things of eternal significance will happen here this morning. We pray all this in your name. Amen.
Say that loosely for some of y'all. Especially this one coming here. Keep on coming. You can't count that high. What you laughing about? Come on, Caleb. There's my friend Colton. Okay, let's all kind of turn around so Miss Donna can get a picture of this beautiful thing. Come on, Mr. Charles Harrell Jr. Come on, boys. Roland, come over here. Can you see everybody? Come on, guys. Can you see?
This way.
Shh. I'm the boss here. Colton, turn around so Miss Donna can see. Okay, can you see Caleb? No. BB, y'all, yeah. Good job. Because they're angels. Come on, little Charles Harrell. Come on. Get right in here. Okay. All right, good. Okay. Well, who knows what we're doing today?
Lighting one candle.
Lighting one candle. You know why? Because we're starting Advent. Does anybody have any idea what Advent means?
Christmas,
God. It means coming or preparing for someone to come. So who are we preparing to come? Jesus. We're preparing for Jesus to be born in the cradle, remember? But you know what? Jesus is not only going to be born in the cradle, but he's going to be coming again. And we all want to be ready for when he's coming again. Well, today, our lesson is on prophets. Anybody know what a prophet is? That's somebody God talked to and told them. It's all in the Old Testament. All those people that wrote those were prophets. God talked to them and told him what to put in the Bible. And so we're talking about prophets today. Let me get my old spectacles on. God made some promises to his people a very long time ago. He promised that they would never be alone, that he would protect them and give them a future. But the greatest promise of all is that he would send someone to save them. Who do you think that's going to be? Jesus, right. So God's people waited for the promise to come. They waited and they waited and they waited some more. Have you ever had to wait for something for a long time?
Me.
It's not fun, is it? Well, these people waited forever. The people who shared God's promises with his people were called prophets. One prophet named Isaiah had this to say, "But the Lord will give you proof. A virgin will have a baby, a son, and we will name him Emmanuel." Now, this was years and years and years before Jesus was born, and God had told him this was going to happen. That meant that she was going to have a baby. So the promise for God that Isaiah shared was that a young woman was going to have a baby boy. So as we light the first candle this week, Rylan, since you've stolen the lighter, I guess you'll light. You got it? Light the first candle. As we light the first candle, teach your children the following line. It will show up each week. Now, I want y'all to remember this line. Can you get it? Let me write it for you. So we lit the first purple candle. So each week, we're going to say this. God's people waited for the promise to come true. Can we say that together? God's people waited for the promise to come true. Another prophet also had this message. Bethlehem, you are the one of the smallest towns in the nation of Judah, but the Lord will choose one of your people to rule the nation, someone whose family goes back a long, long way. Have you ever heard of Bethlehem?
Yes.
What happened there?
They were born.
Right. That's where Jesus was born. Different prophets told that God promised that in Bethlehem a baby boy would be born years and years and years and years before. A baby boy that would be named Jesus, and he would be the Savior. Do you think that God was going to keep this promise? Do you think God keeps his promises? He keeps all his promises. That's for sure. All his promises. But it took a very long time. That doesn't mean that when we ask God for something, it's going to happen right away. That's why we're only lighting one candle today, because we have to wait till next week to find out what we're going to talk about next week. The people were waiting for their Savior, and then finally they got to rejoice that God had kept his promise. What can we rejoice about today? What's our saying? God's people waited for the promise to come true. Okay, let's bow our heads. Thank you, God, for keeping your promise to send a Savior. Help us to wait for you this season and to rejoice in what you do in our lives. Amen. Thank y'all for coming, and I'll see you next week, and we're going to talk about angels. Ooh.
Praise him, oh, you little children. God is love. God is love.
You want the children's church? Or you want to go back to Papa?
Praise him.
About that town of Bethlehem that Christ promised,
good job,
promised to be born, and Scripture says the promise was made, God hath fulfilled. Let's stand as we sing. Oh, little town of Bethlehem. Yet in thy dark street shine.
Lord, we just thank you so much for this day and all that you have blessed us with. Lord, help us to count our blessings. Lord, I pray you just light a fire in us and help us to live a life that reflects you, God, not only in this church but outside it. Lord, with our families, help them to see the love of Jesus in us. Lord, and I just thank you so much that you are the reason for the season. And Lord, oh, how we need you now. God, light a fire in us and may it start here and spread throughout this country. We are so blessed to live in a free nation, Lord, where them freedoms are being attacked each and every day. Thank you for those who fight for the freedoms we have. And may you be with them and their families during this season. In Jesus' name we pray.
I feel the touch of hands so kind and tender. They're leading me in paths that I must trod. I have no fear, for Jesus walks beside me, and I'm sheltered in the arms of God. So let the storms rage high, the dark clouds rise, they won't worry me, for I'm sheltered safe within the arms of God. He walks with me, and all of earth can harm me, for I'm sheltered in the arms of God. Soon I shall hear the call from heaven's portals. Come home, my child, it's the last mile you must trod. Then I'll fall asleep and wake in God's new heaven. Sheltered, safe within the arms of God. So let the storms rage high, the dark clouds rise, they won't worry me, for I'm sheltered safe within the arms of God. He walks with me, and naught of earth can harm me, for I'm sheltered in the arms of God. For I'm
God's people said, amen. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much for that great, great classic song there today. Isn't Christmas wonderful? It's just magical. I mean, we just leave for a few days, and all of a sudden, inside and outside is Christmas. The elves are all around, and they're at work, and what a wonderful time it is. And we do trust that all of you had a wonderful and safe and happy Thanksgiving time together with your family and friends. And all of us ate too much. This is the season of start a new diet every Monday morning. And I mean, that's what we have to do, just start over again every week and try to keep things in control. But what a great, great time of the year it is. I'm glad you're here today. It's good to see every one of you, and I thank you for being a part of this service and coming. Ms. LaWanda has already set the tone for us today as we have begun this season of Advent. As we think about these Sundays prior to Christmas Eve, particularly, and Christmas Day, I want us to carry on the thought that she has already begun, because I want to speak to you on the topic this morning from a very unusual passage of Scripture, one that you probably won't hear read too very many times, but I think it's fascinating. So if you have your copy of God's Word, turn with me to the book of Deuteronomy over in the Old Testament, not one that we usually call on for a Christmas thought. And I'm reading this morning from the NLT, the New Living Translation, Deuteronomy chapter 18. And we'll read about seven verses there together, and let's begin reading in verse 15. Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 15 through 22. Here in the book of Deuteronomy, Moses is talking to the people. Moses, a prophet of God. God and Moses were very, very close. And in this passage, there is a discussion about the relationship of a true prophet of God and a false prophet of God. And God gives some instruction here that I think is good for us to hear. And that's why perhaps I have entitled this message today, as Ms. LaWanda has set it up for us, talking about promises, promises. Deuteronomy chapter 18. The scripture says, Moses continued, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your fellow Israelites. You must listen to him, for this is what you yourselves requested of the Lord your God when you were assembled at Mount Sinai. You said, don't let us hear the voice of the Lord our God anymore, or see this blazing fire, for we will die. This is what they'd asked for. Then the Lord said to me, what they have said is right. I will raise up a prophet like you from among their fellow Israelites. Now, within that statement, there is a meaning there. I will put my words in his mouth, and he will tell the people everything I command them. Do you see it? I will personally deal with anyone who will not listen to the messages the prophet proclaims on my behalf, but any prophet who falsely claims to speak in my name or who speaks in the name of another God, that's with a little g, must die. Now carefully consider these last two verses. But you may wonder, how will we know whether or not a prophecy is from the Lord? If the prophet speaks in the Lord's name, but his prediction does not happen or come true, you will know that the Lord did not give that message. That prophet has spoken without my authority and need not be feared or reverenced or listened to or respected. Perhaps. How will you know? Promises, promises. How can you tell? How can you trust biblical prophecy? That's my question to you this morning. How can you know? How can you trust the prophetic accuracy of Scripture? It's really quite simple. This passage tells us, but if you think about it, it makes perfect sense. Did what was prophesied actually happen? That was easy, wasn't it? Did what was prophesied actually happen? Now let me give you a simple illustration. I stand here today before you in this pulpit, in church, you might say. And I say to you, at noon tomorrow, I'm coming to your house and I'm going to bring to you a pecan pie. You say, now Brother Vic wouldn't tell me a tale. He's my pastor. He's the preacher. He's in church. He's in the pulpit preaching his message. And he said he was going to bring me a pecan pie tomorrow at noon. I know he's probably got some pecans. I've heard he can cook, and he's a pretty decent cook sometimes. And he said he wouldn't fib to me. He said he was going to bring me a pecan pie at noon tomorrow. And on and on and on and on you could go. I mean, you could say 100 things about what I just promised you, right? But now, as we say, what would be the acid test if tomorrow at noon I drive up in your driveway and I get out of my car and hand to you a hot pecan pie, right? What was prophesied actually came true or not? That the prophet has spoken with my authority. I used to have a great friend years ago. And you know how people will do in conversation. They'll just sometimes say things that they probably ought not to say. But you know in conversation, you say, I'm going to come see you. And what do? You don't. They would say that to him. And they would say, I'm going to come by one day and I'm going to take you to lunch on me, my treat. And he had a great response that I loved. He would look right at them. They'd make two or three promises like that. He would look right at them. He would say, make me know it. I thought about that a long time before I really understood what he was really saying. What he was really saying, if you promise me something, make it come to pass. Make it come true. I think oftentimes that you and I think about the promises that God has made to us, and we're not really sure. We don't really know. We haven't really looked. That's exactly what this passage is teaching us. God's word is filled with prophecy. Much of it in the Old Testament. That is indeed true. A lot of it, particularly surrounding the birth of Christ. That is fascinating to trace all of that. All of the promises, most of the ones in the Old Testament. There are a lot of promises, however, in the New Testament as well. And we need to be aware of all of those. Some have said, those theologians who look at certain things like this and count, that there are at least 300 prophecies relating to the birth of Christ, maybe closer to 400 in the Bible, in God's Word. The earliest one that we know of is found in the book of Genesis, in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. That particular passage of Scripture has to do with a conversation with Eve. And God says to her, I will cause enmity or hostility between you and the woman, between your offspring and her offspring, between Satan's offspring and Eve's offspring. And then God says this, he will strike your heel, or he will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. Now, here's the interesting thing about that passage of Scripture in Genesis chapter 3. That passage of Scripture was probably dated, the dates vary a little bit, but it's about 1,500 years before the birth of Christ. 1,500 years. Another one that we look at a lot of times this time of the year in the book of Isaiah, one of our favorite prophets, particularly concerning the Christ of God who came. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14 is one that we read a lot this time of the year. Look, a virgin will conceive and will bear a son, and she will call him Emmanuel, which is God with us. The interesting thing about that is that prophecy dates 700 years before Jesus was born. Micah 5:2, one of our favorite ones this time of the year. But you, Bethlehem, Ephratah, in the land of Judah, we're going to look at that a little bit more in detail. It takes up all of these things about the life and times of Jesus and predicts, promises, prophesies a specific place, a place for Jesus to be born. 800 years before Christ came. And then Hosea chapter 11 is an interesting one. Hosea chapter 11 verse 1. When Israel was a child, I loved him and I called my son out of Egypt. That prophecy is 800 years before Christ. Who in the world would make these kind of statements 1,500 years, 700 years, 800 years, 800 years before something was going to happen? I'll tell you one that even strikes me greater than that. In the 22nd Psalm, Psalm chapter 22, the crucifixion is depicted in a couple of verses there, in about verse 16 through 18. This was 1,000 years before Christ was born. And do you know that in this accurate prediction, I want you to just make a note of that and read it. We can't take time to do it. In this prediction about the crucifixion of Christ, 1,000 years before Christ was born, crucifixion wasn't even known as a method of execution. Now just weigh that for a minute. So prophecy promises, all of these promises and prophecies. So I want you to see some simple things. How many times prophecy can be foretelling, but it can also be forthtelling, as we say and as we sing. So I want you to consider with me just one of these passages that we looked at this morning. We could probably do 50 sermons on the prophecies of Christ. There are roughly 50 passages of Scripture that deal directly, at least, with the birth of Christ. But I want to just take one. Let's take the passage from Micah that we looked at a moment ago. Micah 5:2, one of our favorite ones. And if you want to turn there, go ahead and turn over to that chapter and verse 2. A ruler from Bethlehem. But you, O Bethlehem Ephratah, are only a small village among all the people of Judah. Yet, a ruler of Israel, whose origins are in the distant past, will come from you on my behalf. I want you to see and consider here, in this one prophecy, that prophecy is sometimes the story of a place. A place. Bethlehem is one of the oldest cities maybe the oldest city on earth today. Bethlehem is just 5 miles from Jerusalem, south of Jerusalem. It was first mentioned more than 1,250 years before Christ. If you look at history, Bethlehem literally means the house of bread, house of bread. It's in a fertile place, a very fertile valley and a plain there where lots of things grow. Ephrata can also mean place of fruitfulness. And these are fitting. But Bethlehem dates to probably about the time that Judah invaded the land of Canaan, when Israel went into Canaan to overtake the Canaanites. Old city means house of bread or house of fruitfulness. How fitting that in the place called the house of bread, he who is known as the bread of life would be born. How fitting in this place, Ephrata, known as the place of fruitfulness, Jesus, the bread of life, who can take a barren life and make it into something productive and fruitful, was predicted, promised to be born. But there are many, many other interesting things about the city of Bethlehem. Let me just mention two or three just to stir your curiosity and your thinking, and you can perhaps search out more. It was in Bethlehem that Rachel, Jacob's wife, gave birth to a son named Benjamin. She died in the act of giving birth to that little boy, and she is buried just outside of Bethlehem. Significant in history because of these documentable things. Bethlehem has that rich history. It is the story of a woman named Ruth, a book in our Bible that we don't look at too very much, but a woman who had a very interesting story. Here in Bethlehem, she found redemption from her troubled and difficult past, and found from difficulty and the pain that she endured, and redemption from that. It was also the place of David. David was anointed king over Israel in Bethlehem. And similarly, Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, was predicted, promised to be born in this specific place. Jesus, the good shepherd, the great shepherd, came and was visited by shepherds in this place, Bethlehem, not the least of which is this prophecy here. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah. What was the reason? Why? No other reason except the voice of God speaking hundreds of years before the birth of Christ. And there, Jesus was born. Prophecy is the story sometimes of a place, but it also can be the story of a plan. Prophecy in that verse is interesting. But you, O Bethlehem Ephratah, are only a small village among all the people of Judah. Yet, a ruler of Israel will come from you on my behalf. God is saying something to us there. God has always had a plan. We looked at Genesis chapter 3 there a moment ago, and in that conversation between God and the serpent and Eve, we got that first glimpse. God said in that Genesis conversation, there is a Redeemer who is going to come, and Eve, he's going to be of your seed, and he is going to defeat Satan. God has always had a plan working. And later in the scripture, we find that this Redeemer who was going to come would be at work, and he was going to release Israel from bondage in Egypt. The blood of the Lamb was smeared over the doorposts, and the people were spared there. God provided for them water and manna in the middle of the desert where there was nothing to eat and nothing to drink. God has always been involved with a plan. Israel received the law in a sacrificial system at Mount Sinai, the tabernacle and the priesthood and the sacrifices, all part of God's plan. We read a moment ago about Isaiah. A child will be born, a virgin will conceive and bear a son. Son, and he will be a suffering servant. He will endure pain, but he will be the Messiah for the world because this was God's plan. And Micah reveals him born in this place called Bethlehem. Now, how old is God's plan? We can't put years on it because we don't know how old eternity past is. Want to take a shot at that one? I don't. But that's what he said. This plan has been going on from eternity past. God looked at man and somehow he said, I know they're going to need a Savior. And so he purposed in eternity past to send this son at this specific place, his only one, who would die for the sin of all. And it would be a sufficient sacrifice in the system to redeem anyone and everyone. And he designed that plan that he's been working all of this time with you and me in mind. It still works today. It's still efficacious today. And he said, I want to declare to you that he is coming again. He included you and me in this plan. Praise be to God. Thanks be to God that he loved us and was working out all of the necessary things even while we were yet sinners. He determined to place somebody in our path who would nurture us and teach us and tell us and show us about this plan, which is as old as eternity. And in the appropriate time, they, as we say, witnessed to us. He made that plan and he worked that plan. He's always had a plan. Prophecy is the story of a place sometimes, but it's also the story of a plan. But also, it can be and is the story of a person. Look at that passage again. But you, Bethlehem, that's the place, Ephrathah, a small village among the clans of Judah. Yet a ruler of Israel will come from you on my behalf. That statement, that little short sentence, God promises a person to come from him for all of us. What a magnificent promise that he will come from Bethlehem, but his real origins are elsewhere. His real origin is from antiquity. His real origin is from eternity. And this prophetic story from Bethlehem, this promise, this prophecy is that God is going to become one of us. Remember that from that passage in Deuteronomy that we read a moment ago. He said, I will raise up a prophet like you from among you, but he will come and will speak for me. That's what Jesus did. This story, Jesus became one of us. When God placed himself somehow miraculously, and we can't explain that, how did God make Mary great with child, his only son? Did Jesus lose something? No, nothing at all. He just added humanity to his deity. When Mary looked down at that baby in that cradle there, she was looking at a baby who was as much a man as any other man ever has been man, but as much God as God is God. That's the miracle of this prophecy. He was 100% God and 100% man. The miracle the miracle of all of the ages. And Jesus came to reveal to us, God said, the invisible God, to offer sacrifice for the sin of all mankind, to reconcile us, to be an example before us and for us, to destroy Satan and that curse that we read about in Genesis there a moment ago, to heal those who needed healing and to give life to everyone, to bring abundant life to all of us, to glorify His Father and to fulfill prophecy. And He came because He loves every one of us and He wants us to be saved. I read an interesting story about the absolute improbability of prophecy. Some years ago in a book called Science Speaks, two authors there, Peter Stoner and Robert Newman, wrote an interesting piece about this business of prophecy. There, as I told you a moment ago, there are some 50 well-known prophecies surrounding the birth of Christ. Peter Stoner and Robert Newman said that if you took just 8 of those 50, pick the 8 best known prophecies about Christ, they said the mathematical probability of just 8 of those prophecies coming to pass was a number that I can't even describe. I can tell you mathematically what it is. It's 10 to the 17th power. That means 10 times 10 times 10 times 10 times 10, 17 times. We can't even get that number on the screen. 10 times 10 times 10, 17 times. And then Stoner and Newman went on to describe it. They said, just to help you understand a little bit better, let's do an illustration. They said, and so they did it this way. They said, if you could collect that many silver dollars, 10 times 10 times 10 times 10, 17 times, it would be enough silver dollars to cover the state of Texas 2 feet deep in silver dollars. Think of that. And in that coverage of the state of Texas, silver dollars, 2 feet deep, 10 times 10 times 10 times 10, one of those silver dollars would have a black X marked on it. Just one. Indelible marker, X. Somewhere in that mix. Stir them all up, all across the state of Texas. Stir up 10 times 10 times 10 times 10, silver dollars. Take a man and blindfold him and turn him loose and tell him to walk across Texas, and whenever he felt like stopping, stop and reach down and pick up one silver dollar, and he stops and reaches down and picks up out of all those silver dollars the one with a black X on it. Peter Stone and Robert Newman said, that's the statistical probability that the prophecies of God, just 8 out of the 50, would be perfectly fulfilled in one man. We can say a lot more about Bethlehem. We can say a lot more about the Savior. Oh, we can say so much more about prophecy. But you see, the real question goes back to my original question to you this morning. Do you believe the story? Have you trusted in God's promise to us? His prophecy. Well, the real question is, do you really believe what was actually prophesied really came true? Did it really happen? You should, because it did. You must, because it came for you. The scripture says there is salvation in none other. There is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. You must believe that what was prophesied actually happened. Promises, promises. I think not. I think rather prophecy fulfilled. Would you pray with me? At close of this service time, now, Heavenly Father, may your Spirit be active and fervent in our midst this morning. Perhaps there is someone here today who has come face to face with the prophetic statements of these multiple scriptures. Perhaps someone has delayed that which they have needed to do for a long, long time. Prophecy doesn't really affect me. It's so old. All of this is ancient stuff. It happened so long ago, and yet in the midst of these prophetic statements, we see fresh and new and once again in this Advent season that what you promised, you actually carried out. What you promised came to pass. What you foretold, what you said you would do, you did. In the person and the presence of Christ, the Lord Himself, the King of glory, your only Son, who miraculously, according to the promise, according to the plan, came at a specific time and came as one of us. To live among us and to die. It is for us to accept the promise and to take Him into our heart and let Him change us and to live there as King of Kings and Savior of our life. Oh, Father, I pray today that someone here would make Him Lord of all. Thank you for this invitation time. Thank you for these who've come to share. We may never meet again. Just exactly like this moment, and how we pray that your perfect will might be done in some heart and life here today. Bless, we pray. Maybe someone needs to come on profession of faith. Maybe someone needs to come on transfer of a letter or by statement from a church of like faith, and or in any way that we receive members as the Gillsburg Baptist Church. As we open the doors just now, would you be honored and you be praised and you be pleased and you be glorified because your plan has taken effect in someone's life today. Bless just now in the matchless name of Christ. We're going to stand quietly to our feet. Brother Doug's going to lead us in singing a verse of hymn of invitation. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Make my life useful to thee. If there's a decision that you would register, would you step on out? Would you come this morning? Come just now as we sing. Would you come? Come on. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Come on. Would you come? We're going to sing another stanza. If you come, come on. Come this morning. Would you come? Profession of faith, transfer of your letter. Would you come? Thank you so much for your kind attention, your faithfulness to this house. I know there are a lot of things going on this time of the year and a lot of activities and gatherings and so forth, but I trust that you'll be faithful to all these services. We've got a raft of things scheduled here over the next couple of weeks, particularly this week with the missionaries coming on Wednesday evening. Everybody is going to meet together to hear them. You don't want to miss this presentation. This is an up-to-date, up-to-the-minute report from the mission field. These missionaries are about to go back after the first of the year back to South America. So you'll want to hear them and hear what they have to say about what's going on in the real world down there. So come and be a part of that. And then next Sunday, we're going to have a great, great time of gospel music and Christmas music and some testimonies that you don't want to miss. So I hope you'll be in your place. Remember, we'll not have Sunday school. Our service will start at 10:30. It'll be activities for the children. So come and be a part of that. So you come and hear Faith's journey. You'll be blessed because you did. Thank you again for being here today. God bless you. Have a great afternoon as we close out our Thanksgiving season. Let's go away rejoicing because we have been involved in worship and freedom today. What a blessing God has given to us with the privilege of worship. Father, thank you for the privilege of being here today and for the many, many blessings that all of us have enjoyed this past week and this time of Thanksgiving. Thank you for this wonderful land called America in which we live and for the manifold blessings that are ours as we live here. Continue to make us mindful that freedom is never free. And someone has paid the price. Someone has gone ahead and paved the way for us and that we enjoy what we enjoy today because of the sacrifice for others. So as we have now entered this Advent season, help us to focus upon the Christ. There are so many things that draw us away. And how I pray that we might be able to focus on him amidst all the glitz and the glamour and the tinsel and the lights. And I pray that we'll be able to see Jesus in his rightful position and his rightful place. And now this morning, may you receive this blessing as we go from this place. May you have the gladness of Christmas, which is hope. May you have the spirit of Christmas, which is peace. And may you have the heart of Christmas, which is love. And we ask and do pray it in the matchless name of Christ and for his sake. And all his people said together in agreement, amen and amen. Thank you.